So today's session is more about some of the common mistakes that usually happen when we are talking about the implementation or understanding of the POSH Act 2013. Now, of course, in a 1 hour conversation, there is an extent to width which we can cover all those pointers, but we have tried to squeeze in as many mistakes as possible from the time constraint perspective, but we will try and cover as many as possible. If there are things which have been left out, which you believe should be raised, we'll be happy to take them up at the end of the conversation. So the mistakes that we are talking about are not usually just made from one end. We'll be covering them from four different angles today. Mistakes which are usually made by the legal function or individual who is guiding the organization on this specific area of compliance. Mistakes made by HR as they go about implementing and ensuring that the guidelines are put in place. Mistakes made by the internal committee during any investigation, be it formal or informal, preliminary. And lastly, the mistakes made by management. Ideally, we would have liked to begin by the mistakes made by the management, but we have kept them for the last because we will see how many of the mistakes usually arise or happen because it should begin from the knowledge and understanding from the most senior of the leadership in the organization and how this specific law is being positioned. In the day-to-day conversation is more of a social initiative instead of a business initiative. But we'll get to that by the end of the last few slides where we talk about how management ends up contributing and who are they relying on when it comes to get equipping themselves with the appropriate knowledge of this law. So to begin with, let's look at mistakes made by legal. The first and foremost thing is that they don't really look at it as a mandatory compliance at all. We are not even talking about applicability for all kinds of setup, but there's this misconception that this is not really a compliance which companies or entities have to think about. It's an optional thing. And the only time a specific company has to start worrying about POSH compliance is when they have crossed 10 members, or when they have enough number of members, or when they have a specific entity. Maybe they have to be a company or they have to be a commercial venture. We speak to a lot of individuals who guide certain kinds of setup, especially startups, NGOs, non-commercial ventures, wherein the understanding is that this law is not applicable to us. Even after 7 years of this law being in picture, this is the core or the crux of the mistake that companies end up making when they are not implementing the guidelines of this law in their complete sense. Now, this applicability is also further segmented into how the law is being talked about. In most of the places, you will read the applicability of the law is connected with a specific number of employee count, which is 10. What we need to understand is that 10 is the only 10 employee count is only relevant whether a company has to constitute an internal committee or not. But other than that, all other guidelines mentioned under POSH Act are still applicable even if you have less than 10 members. You still have to have a policy in place. You still have to have a individual internal member who are at least briefing for the HR, because in whichever organization there are less than 10 members, they still have to create all the necessary preventive, prohibitive, and redressal mechanism. The only difference is there's no internal committee, but as and when any complaint comes in, the HR or the company internally have to ensure that these complaints are routed to local complaints committee so that they can be addressed. But in the absence of this understanding, in the absence of knowing that irrespective of our employee count, we still are required to be compliant with this law, except the condition on having an internal committee, none of these things are being undertaken. The second mistake that is made by legal is not submitting the declaration under the director's report under Companies Act. Now, this was an amendment which came out in August of 2018, which is after 5 years of this law being enacted, wherein every company wherein they are submitting their director's report to the MCA and they're filing their necessary documentation, there's an additional declaration that has to be submitted by the directors declaring that they have complied with the necessary provisions of POSH Act and they have constituted the internal committee. Now, this is absent in a lot of organizations, and even if it is being signed and it is being submitted as part of the standard template, not having it implemented on ground creates further and higher legal and financial consequences for any company. Now, there is no way for any other individual in the organization or outside the organization to know about it or to execute this process, because these filings are usually done by and in the guidance of the legal individual. So they should be the one to know that this is the declaration that needs to be filed other than the annual compliance report. And at the same time, if this declaration is getting filed, then it has to be implemented in the organization as well. The fine for this non-compliance or discrepancy can be equivalent to as high as 50 lakh rupees per director. And that's why a lot of companies are also going for director's insurance. That's one way to protect yourself. But at the end of the day, a repeat violation on the same is not going to work in company's favor, as it can also call for cancellation of business license. Third mistake made by legal is not keeping the documentations on various activities of the implementation. See, we have to go back to the first point here, where this is not an HR procedure. It is not an internal initiative or an initiative that a company can opt or choose whether to go or not to go about. This is a compliance. When it is a compliance, there are necessary papers, submissions required for different authorities. One is the director's report. Second is your annual compliance report that needs to be submitted to the district officers every calendar year. Now, every calendar year means that in the month of January, there's no specific date which has been given, but at least in the first 10 days, this report, which contains some special aspects pertaining to the implementation, should be put in as a letter and should be shared with the employer of the organization as well as the district officer. If you have multiple branches and different locations, you would have formed different ICs also, and you can submit a consolidated report to the district officer of your head office branch. But at the same time, you need to make sure that you submit the same report to the respective locations, district officers also, because for them, the location of your operation falls under their jurisdiction. And it is crucial that they know that you have submitted your annual compliance report for that particular branch or not. Now, some of the district officers have also started asking for further proofs, which means that if you are submitting your annual compliance report as per the format given under the Act, in addition to that, some district officers may also ask you proof for the number of awareness programs that you have conducted. They may also ask you for the details of the meetings that the internal committee was undertaking during the course of whole year. They may also ask you for the status of the complaints that have been received without violating the confidentiality guidelines. See, under the POSH Act, the central ministry has authorized the state departments, and the state departments have given the district officers this responsibility and this authority to ask for necessary additional information as and when they feel that it is important for them to know about it. In the absence of such proofs, as and when required by the district officers, they also have the right to penalize the companies for the same. And that is where maintaining proper documentation on different activities of the implementation becomes very crucial. Another mistake that legal usually end up making is not creating a check and balance system within the organization for IC and HR. See, now under the law, it has been clearly mentioned that the internal committee constituted under this act is required to function independently during an investigation. Now, what it actually means is that the internal committee as an equivalent body of civil court within an organization with some of the powers given under as the civil court, they are to handle a specific complaint and investigate the witnesses, evidences, and the facts and the truths of the matter without getting any influence or without bringing any bias into the picture. That is what it means to have an independent investigation of any other aspect of the organization. However, any implications, any consequences of the mistakes done during investigation are not something which the IC has been made accountable for under the law. Even internally in a lot of organizations, companies and the management, they are not creating any KRAs or KPIs for the IC performance. What happens in the absence of this is internal committee continues to operate as per their own understanding, no matter how best, how good, how bad, in whichever category that we want to look at it. But whatever they are doing it as per the best of their knowledge that they have received during any internal committee training programs. But the outcome of it, which means that whether they have ensured that all the timelines are met, whether they have ensured that all the complaints that have come to them are being addressed in a time-bound manner, are all the documents in place? Are they following the standard set of procedure? Have they created or have they taken a specific decision which is not in line with the traditional policies of the organization? Have they made sure that all the aspects that the law is asking them to ensure during an ongoing investigation and even post the investigation, they are being taken care of? There is no audit mechanism for internal committee to know whether they are on the right path or not. And the consequences will not be on them. The consequences will fall back on the company. In this particular manner, it's very crucial that when the legal department or the legal individual of any organization is handling this area of compliance, they also create a check and balance system. Now, today, in our limited time, we do not have the opportunity to talk about what kind of check and balance can be created for the internal committees, how to ensure that without violating confidentiality guidelines of this law, the legal or HR, whoever is assigned internally, can make sure that the internal committees are functioning properly. But in one of our future sessions, we'll definitely take this up. The fifth mistake that legal usually ends up making is not briefing the management and other associated functions from a legal lens. Because it's a matter of compliance, it eventually falls upon the shoulders of the legal function and the legal head to make sure that the company's decision makers, stakeholders, individuals who are appointed as internal committee members, they understand the severity of the nature of activities that are being undertaken when we talk about workplace sexual harassment. Unlike any other form of misconduct in a company, which could be about bribery or fraud or any money-related matter or any other misconduct for that matter, this particular violation, any form of workplace sexual harassment, comes under a legal provision. A company can build on top of it without violating or contradicting any of the guidelines, but they have to make sure that the necessary provisions mentioned in the law are being put in place. If a complaint of workplace sexual harassment has to be undertaken by internal committee only, then there is no way that an HR function or an HR leader can look into those complaints. If a complaint of workplace sexual harassment and its relevant investigation procedure has to be documented, then there's no way that a verbal meeting or a verbal engagement can happen, and nobody and no document trail is being created for it. If it is said that an internal committee has to function independently without bringing any bias from the employer, from any other authority individual in the organization, then the internal committee has to function independently and not disclose any of the details of the investigation with anybody else. There's so many provisions, so many activities, so many decisions that internal committee has to take. And the management also has to understand that they have to stay separate and away from these specific activities. But they will not be able to understand it until and unless it is briefed to them. This particular law is introduced to them as a compliance mandate and not just a mandate which the company can decide or play around with internally. The last thing where legal makes a mistake is keeping the compliance activities pushed till the end of the year. It's September already, and I'm speaking about it from not just this year's experience, but it's almost an every year thing that when we know that earlier when companies used to believe that the annual compliance report has to be submitted from a financial year perspective, we will know that by January companies will start thinking about it because either their CA or CS or some legal counsel in their team is now asking them about the annual compliance report, and they have to fill that report for submission. The same way, ever since companies have now realized that it's not the financial year, but now it's the calendar year when the annual compliance report is to be submitted. Somewhere around September, October is when we start hearing more from the companies that we need to finish these activities as soon as possible because we have to submit a report. Now, that's a mistake. You will, of course, check some of the boxes if you have to just put some numbers in your ACR, which is annual compliance report. The problem with that is that if ever your district officer does ask you for proofs, which means that if you're writing that we have conducted 3 awareness sessions in this calendar year, and the person and the district officer demands a proof from your organization, you will not be able to create a backdated document around it. We have seen some companies doing that also. Of course, there's always a way to play around with the law, but that's not really the smartest or the wisest thing to do. Instead of that, it's much better if you pace out the activities for POSH Act. Simple thing, you have to conduct awareness session. So in the whole year, based on the number of employees that you have, how many awareness sessions would you like to do? What kind of awareness activities you would like to do? How many times you would like to conduct those awareness sessions? How many hours you would like to devote? What will be the way to document the learnings? And how will you monitor that each and every person has been part of these awareness programs? So a strategy at the end of the year can easily be created. Same thing for the IC capacity building and training programs, for IC meetings. We work with organizations wherein we have the whole calendar, the whole year planned out, including the internal committee's quarterly meetings and what exactly will be the agenda for those meetings. And this is how smoothly it can actually be managed. But most of the time, these 6 things end up happening in organization primarily from the legal side. Before we move on to the HR, anyone wants to share something specific from their end? Any question, any comment at this point in time?
Hello. Pallavi, am I audible to you?
Yes, you're audible.
Okay, this is a point where you spoke about, I'm sorry, I have not made a point there. I think you spoke about whether a complaint has to be taken care by the IC irrespective, whether the complainant wishes so or not. Is that what you said?
No, that's not what I'm saying. See, that's okay. A different part altogether. If the complainant does not want to file a written complaint and the complainant does not want their identity to be disclosed, then there is no way the internal committee can go ahead with the investigation.
They don't have to take a suo motu cognizance in such cases?
See, the suo motu cognizance that the court is talking about is not for the committee. They can register it and they can actually share it with the HR. So what happened, does this particular suo motu cognizance that you're talking about is very specific, wherein if I bring a complaint to you and you are part of the committee and I share an incident, but for some reason, either I don't want to disclose my identity or I don't want my identity to be disclosed to the respondent. And second, if I don't wish to file a written complaint. In these two situations, IC cannot carry on with the formal investigation as per the guidelines because it's violating the principles of natural justice. Right.
Okay.
But at the same time, IC cannot say that now we will not do anything. Right. So the suo motu cognizance that this law, that the specific judgment that was introduced in is more about that IC then should actually forward this particular complaint to the HR so that something can be done. Because if you can't take an action under POSH Act, companies do have code of conduct and other disciplinary guidelines under which this thing should still be taken into cognizance.
Okay. Okay. Got it.
Any other question by any of the other members here? All right, let's look at the HR then. So the first mistake that HR ends up making is considering this as an internal policy activity instead of a compliance activity. What it means basically is that HR will not really know whether these awareness sessions, gender sensitization sessions, making sure that each and every person is aware of their rights, they should be knowing about who the IC is, when they should approach the IC. All these are good to do instead of must do, right? And not understanding the distinction between. And please understand that the mistakes by HR is not because the HR doesn't want to do them. We are talking about all these mistakes sheerly out of ignorance or proper understanding or interpretation or the narrative, in the manner that this law is being talked about. So it's very important for HR to know that this is a compliance activity, which means going back to the law, legal text, and checking that when the law says that awareness programs have to be conducted, what exactly does the law's intent here? What do they want to achieve? Because only if you understand the intent of the law and the mandates given under the law, you will be able to create the necessary provisions for implementation here. It is not about conducting two sessions in a year or one session a year. The law says that when we talk about conducting awareness program, everyone in the organization should be aware of it so that tomorrow, if ever there is a case of, or if there's a incident of workplace sexual harassment, your team members, your employees should know where to reach out for help. So in the absence of this knowledge, in the absence of this information, if your employees tomorrow end up writing something on social media or they end up going to the police station or they approach the courts directly, in fact, in one of the instances, we have also seen in some judgments where the complainant has directly approached the court and the court has sent it back to the company saying that this is not a matter that we should be hearing first. It's something that should be handled internally. And the complainant actually did not know that there is an internal provision where she should be bringing this information to. This could have been easily handled and addressed if the awareness program would have been conducted properly. But that's not how HR most of the time is introduced to this law. When they are told that they have to conduct awareness session, it usually comes as part of the list of the activities that this year we want to conduct these many sessions and please conduct gender sensitization sessions also. But your gender sensitization sessions can still be secondary. Your first and foremost awareness session is about the existence of internal committee, why they exist, in which situations you should be reaching out to them, how they will be handling these investigations, ensuring that employees are aware of certain provisions like confidentiality, not fearing retaliation, not worrying about losing their job, and so many other things, so that trust, a trust and a streamlined communication can be built between those who are potential aggrieved for instances of sexual harassment and the internal redressal authority, which is your internal committee. The second mistake that usually happens through HR's desk is planning awareness session based on the internal budgets and other priorities. It's connected with the first one because when you are looking at internal budgets and you have to squeeze in these gender sensitization and awareness sessions as part of them, you're not really prioritizing these sessions as a compliance activity. You are looking at these sessions as one of the activities that needs to be done this year or that could be done this year. Instead, awareness sessions and IC's training sessions are part of the compliance mandate. They are also part of your annual compliance report, wherein you have to submit the number of sessions that you have conducted for that year. You also have to create a monitoring mechanism and any way in which you can document who all were part of these sessions, whether all the employees have been made aware of it, which were the dates. If any employee has not been part of certain sessions, then you should actually create other provisions to educate them about it. And these awareness sessions are not just one-time activity. They are regular. Even in the law, even in the legal text, it's clearly mentioned that these regular awareness sessions should be conducted to educate employees about their rights and procedures under this law. So the word regular, yes, it should be anything more than one. But even two sessions in a year do not really count as regular session. Now, if the HR were briefed about this particular law and this specific activity, usually it's HR, but even under HR, I would put it as training and development and learning and development functions. In large organizations, all these activities are further divided to respective decision makers. So for L&D also, it's very important to know that yes, communication skills and stress management and other team building activities for the employees are to be conducted, but those are not under a compliance mandate. But your awareness session of POSH are under a compliance mandate and you have to execute them. You have to strategize and execute them in a very structured manner. The third mistake that usually gets done by HR is identifying and appointing the internal committee members. Every time we have this discussion with HR, wherein they want to know who can be part of the committee and who can be nominated, and they want to go about sending them these letters, or they don't even send them letters at times. Actually, their names are directly put in notices, and they have just told over an email that you're part of the committee. This is not the way to go about it, because even in the legal text, it's written that it's a duty of the employer to nominate the members of the committee. Sorry, it's the duty of the employer to appoint the members of the committee. And that's what it should be. It's not the HR who should be deciding it. In fact, in one of the judgments that we will actually take in the month of October, you will see that the court questioned the constitution of the committee because no proper documentation was provided by the company that how the IC members were nominated and appointed. There was no paper, there was no board resolution that was cleared off, there was no written appointment letter that was given to the IC, and all these activities of related to appointment were done in a very casual manner. So good practice will be that yes, while HR has to take care of the operational side of things, wherein they can draft the emails and draft the formats and everything else for IC member nomination, but there still has to be a board resolution in place, or if it's a smaller setup, there is no board, then founders, some MOM has to be created. If it's an LLP, then partners, meeting document, some official document which can prove that this decision of IC member selection and nomination was actually taken not by any other function in the organization. It's contradictory and it's also in violation of the law. The next mistake that usually gets done by HR is interfering in IC activities as they could and need to. I don't hold HR very much responsible for it, because once again, I will go back to the first point here. If the HR themselves are not briefed with the necessary understanding that this is a compliance activity and there has to be a clear division of responsibility and accountability of who is going to be doing what and where the sharing of information, declarations, documentation, maintenance, and even the point of contact. This clear division of responsibility and accountability has to be briefed to the HR in order for them to know that, yes, until the internal committee was introduced in the organization, it was the duty of the HR to ensure that no misconduct of any kind should be happening within the company. But under this law, when it comes to workplace sexual harassment incidents, HR will not be handling it. As I said a while ago also, the only time HR's role starts is when the complainant is not willing to have their identity disclosed, or the complainant does not want to file a complaint in writing, or the complainant, which is a very rare case, does not want the IC to handle this case. Now, in the third scenario, usually it's the responsibility of the IC to address all their concerns. And in my experience, in our experience at Ungender, as and when this doubt clarification or concern clarification conversation has happened with a specific aggrieved, we have been able to bypass this particular step. But whenever we talk about, so somewhere HR has to take a back seat when it comes to workplace sexual harassment incidents. And this is an element that should be included in the awareness session and email communications also. If ever an employee has to reach out, they should not reach out to HR. They should be given a number or an email address where they can write directly, or where they can call directly and reach out directly to the members of the internal committee, because the internal committee members are given proper training on how to have these conversations, how to maintain the documentation and records of these conversations. There's quorum identified, there's a guideline identified by the law on how these meetings are to happen. An internal committee procedure is been provided in a very detailed manner, step by step, including the timelines. And how HR will usually look at it will not be this time bound, or may not be aligned with the same principles as this law has identified for internal committees. The next mistake that usually happens is, and once again with a good intent, that they want to be the first point of contact for any IC related complaint. That you come to us, you tell us, and then we will take you to the committee. While it may serve as a good practice initially, because people will take their own time in trusting and finding their faith for these three or four new members that the company has suddenly appointed as internal committee members. Usually in any organization, if an employee has any trouble or any negative experience, any grievance that they want to raise, the only person or the first point of contact for them is usually HR. And that's why HR continues with this specific measure here also. The reason it backfires is, in instances, if I approach the HR first, and HR is going to spend time in understanding what happened and whether they will be the one to decide whether it's a complaint of sexual harassment or not, it puts the company at a huge risk. Either that HR person has been included in the IC trainings and with the same depth that happens for the IC members, then the HR will know what kind of questions to ask, how not to ask. But even that is problematic, because if during this course HR decides that, yes, this is a complaint of sexual harassment and it should be given to the internal committee, the aggrieved will have to go through the same experience again, telling the internal committee about the incidents again, maybe give their complaint in writing again, provide the same anecdotes and experiences and witnesses and evidences again. It's a repeat trauma for an aggrieved. And this can be clearly bypassed if we do not make HR as the point of contact for any complaints pertaining to sexual harassment at workplace. We are not even talking about those scenarios where HR has actually made the mistake of looking into understand or, you know, validating whether a complaint is valid for valid to be brought to the internal committee or not. And later on, they have realized that, yes, it was a matter of internal committees and they should have been the one taken it. In fact, in certain companies, we have seen this happening where after a couple of months, the complainant has reached out to the committee directly. And then they have raised this point that we did reach out to the HR a couple of months ago. And they told us that this was not a matter of workplace sexual harassment. And they have actually dragged the HR person also as part of their complaint. So either way, this particular strategy of making yourself as a first point of contact is not a very fruitful or a positive strategy. If the concern is that the IC members will not be able to respond with the same speed or promptness, then necessary measures can be put in place. You can put in automated email responses. You can identify one individual within the committee who will be responsible for the immediate responses that are required for aggrieved as and when they receive a complaint. So many things can be done to make sure that the IC is prompt in their communication, but not making yourself as a point of contact. And the last is not building their own knowledge and capacity on this law. We have to understand that a lot of companies do not look at POSH activities or POSH compliance or as a legal aspect. And a lot of companies do not even have a full-time legal person guiding them internally. In the absence of that, this particular area of activity falls under HR. And HR really struggles. We have spoken to a lot of HR people wherein they do not even know whether they have to draft a policy. Is that the only piece of documentation that needs to be done? How to choose the IC members, wherein they don't even have to. This is not even their responsibility that they should be choosing. But for them to go back to their employer or to the senior management of the organization and tell them that this is how you're supposed to go about it, they have to first invest in their own knowledge and capacity building around this, which is largely missing as of now. Because there is no specific, I'll actually put the blame mainly on how this law is being talked about, which is not very clear. Is this a social initiative that a company wishes to take? Is this a compliance? Is this part of good HR practices? There's a lot of confusion when people talk about POSH Act or workplace sexual harassment. What exactly is HR's role in this whole scheme of thing is mainly missing from this discussion. And the first and foremost thing that needs to be done is before you even go about, you know, planning awareness session and strategizing them or identifying IC members, the first and foremost thing that any HR should actually do is build their own knowledge and capacity on this law. Before I move on to the mistakes by internal committee, any question, any comment at this point in time?
Yes.
Levy, I have a question again. Can I start first?
Please.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. I just want to check with you how okay it is for HR to be part of the ICs. Because ideally, they should not be. But there are a lot of organizations where they do not have women employees otherwise. And only women employees are in HR. Or the senior women employees are only in HR. So what should be done in these kind of circumstances? Should they be part of the IC then?
So to be very honest, Preeti, right?
Yes.
To be very honest, Preeti, thank you for asking this question. Because see, for HR, what happens is they have to manage to wear multiple hats. See, as it is, being part of the internal committee means that whichever function that you are taking care of, whichever designation that you already have and the roles and responsibilities, you have to set that aside when you walk into a meeting room or an investigation meeting room, right? Now, it becomes all the more difficult when you're also the HR. And when you're HR, right? Because you have to then ensure that you may know so many things about that person. Maybe that person was not performing well. Okay, maybe that person was already problematic from their conduct. Maybe the aggrieved or the respondent has already had previous troubles. So as an HR person, what you're walking in with is a lot more information, prior information that you should be having, right? And that ends up creating a bias very automatically.
Exactly. Yeah. So I understand that. My question is this: should it happen or should not it happen? I mean, what does the law say about it?
Law is silent about it. Law doesn't care. Law only cares about whoever is part of the IC should be able to just decide on a particular allegation based on the facts which are being presented and not bring their biases into picture, which is under the principles of natural justice. So nowhere in the law it is written that HR should not be part of it.
Okay. Yeah. Extension to the same question, Pallavi. Now, if there is a circumstances where sometimes the complainant does not wish to go to the IC, even though the IC is there and there has been enough awareness about it, but she wishes to, let's say, go to a SHEBOX or an LC or to the police. Mm-hmm. In such circumstances, what is the liability and the exposure on the organization?
You're saying that in instances where the complainant has gone to the police or the court?
Yes. Or to the court or to the local complaint committee, or she's directly reached out to the SHEBOX. She's gone anywhere, everywhere except the IC, which is very well present in the organization. And there is enough awareness about it also. But she still chooses to go to other redressal forum and not the the IC. So what is the exposure and the liability of the organization in such cases?
So two things should happen, right? I would say that if the organization has the intent to actually take care of that particular complaint, okay, they should make sure that they reach out to the complainant and understand from them that why did they not come to the internal committee. And now bringing the whole legal context into picture, make sure that you document everything. Right? So, for example, you came to me and you asked me that, Pallavi, we heard so-and-so thing happened. We received a letter from the local complaints committee or from the court or from the police, whatsoever. And why did you not come to us? Then whatever concerns are, please address them. Okay. And once the meeting is done, you create a document, you send a copy to me, and then you say that, Pallavi, we met you today and we wanted to understand, you know, we were concerned that you did not bring this thing to us, and these were your concerns and this is what we answered. This would want to take up this investigation internally. Like, put your best foot forward so that tomorrow the complaining cannot say that I did not bring the complaint to the internal committee because I was not sure whether there will be any retaliation. You can also go back to this meeting and say, but we addressed this thing, Pallavi. I was afraid that I will lose my job. But Pallavi, we addressed this problem also. So you as a company will not be dragged in the court of law.
Okay.
Some judgment wherein the court has recognized that the person did not go to the committee because they did not trust the system internally set. So you please safeguard yourself. Any company should first safeguard themselves. Now, the second thing you should do is, you should, even if Pallavi is still not willing to file a complaint internally, you can't do anything about it, right? But the HR can, right? That's where the suo motu cognizance that you were talking about comes into picture. That if Pallavi, if you get to know that Pallavi has filed a complaint against a male member of the organization, okay, and let's say it's under Section 354 or something else, right? Then, as an HR, some responsibility is there of the organization also to say that, okay, there's a person who is being, you know, alleged for so-and-so. We should take some necessary provisions. If not under POSH, then you can still take some actions under that. Right? And third thing that you should do is provide all necessary support, which is also clearly written in the law that if the aggrieved chooses to file a complaint to the police, it's the duty of the employer to provide all necessary support. Now, what does it mean by all necessary support? Even if it's not a POSH investigation, if Pallavi needs time off to for the court hearings and being there in the LCC or to the police station, please be as supportive as possible. Do you need somebody to go with you? Do you need something? Do you need some time off? And all those things. That's what the court means. That's what the law means by saying that all necessary support, whatever is required.
Okay. Got it.
Yeah. Yes. Any other question? I think Colonel Sapori, you had a question.
Yes. So I think as far as the employees are expected to contact the IC, if I'm not wrong, the law clearly says that posters need to be adequately displayed, giving the details of the IC members, wherein the employees can contact the IC members directly.
Yes.
Fine. The second one is, I just wanted your take on this. The Companies Act 2013 has a separate section on the vigil mechanism. Now, the listed companies are mandated to have a third-party ethics helpline, whistleblowing mechanism, so to say.
Right.
One of the violations which can be reported is sexual harassment. So, be okay for a company to provide auto access to all sexual harassment reports that are filed with the third-party ethics helpline, wherein the IC presiding officer, the presiding member, gets an auto-generated email of all sexual harassment cases filed. I suppose that should be okay. Instead of coming directly to the IC or coming via the HR, that provision should also be okay, I suppose, isn't it? I just wanted your take on that.
Sure. So I'll address the first one first, Colonel Sapori, the notices element, right?
Yeah.
Now, if we go back to the legal text, it says that the employer should put up notices in the workplaces in a conspicuous manner, right? The word conspicuous is very technical here, right? Make the notices noticeable. Now, what do companies usually do? Okay, for the sake of the, the aesthetics or for the sake of just doing it as a check in the box activity, there is a notice board in organizations wherein there are so many other, documents are posted. We have seen that the whole Maternity Act and other labor law provision papers are just printed out in that black and white manner and they're put up there.
Exactly.
How many employees actually go and read them? So even for an employee to go and find that information in the notice board, somebody has to still tell the employee that you will find this information in the notice board.
Yes.
Right? So that is also part of the awareness. Putting the notices is not an awareness enough. Telling people about the notices, the presence of the notices is also important. Second thing. You may put up notice, but they also have to be accessible by different kinds of employees in your organization. An outsider will never go to your notice board and find that information. See, I will do it. You will do it. All the members present here will do it. I do it as a practice. Every workplace that I go to, the first thing that I will see is their notice board, whether they have put the details. But that's because I already know what to look for.
Exactly. Yeah.
Right? Now, even if I know, as an external person, as a visitor, as part of the privileged class, we are privy to this information and knowledge that there should be so-and-so notice in workplaces. Second thing is, we have to understand that is the notice something that I can even understand, right? Language.
Yes.
Most of the places put up these notices in English language.
Yes.
What about other people who do not know how to read English? To the employers, HR, whoever is, assigned with this responsibility, need to make sure the purpose of the notice is one, for people to know, people to read it. Second, for people to know, people to understand what is written on it.
Yeah.
So putting it in multiple language. And the third thing is, put it in as many places as you can where your employees will find this information. So if you have to look at a manufacturing plant, it's all scattered. One single notice board and putting it there is not going to do the job. You have to find the places, maybe like your cafeteria. You will have to find the places that if it's a heavy machinery industry plant, then they will be a spot where different kinds of your employee base have their food. Not everyone goes to the cafeteria and eats. Some people eat in the parking lot. Some people eat under some tree in the same campus. then for them also putting a black and white paper, nobody is going to read because they know that this paper is not for them. All these official looking papers are not for them. So maybe you will have to design the posters differently.
Absolutely.
Right. So the purpose of the notice will only get served if you follow it through with the identifying who all are your employees and who all can be potential complainees under this. Right. A person, let's say a woman who comes to the office to deliver something from Amazon or Zomato or some other place. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
And while receiving that delivery, if that person exchanges an inappropriate conduct, okay, you really think she is going to look for the notice board and, you know, look for the information of the internal committee?
Not at all.
So what we usually say is maybe the first thing that people should be seeing when they come to your office is there's a security guard and there's a register that asks that, okay, who are you? Who do you need to meet? And somebody's taking that. Put a paper there and tell them something like in a language that they can understand that you have just walked into a safe place where we respect certain things. If there's any inappropriate behavior with you, this is where please complain. That brings me to the point which you are talking about. Not everyone will be able to send emails also.
Yeah.
So specify a number. Because it's easy for a lot of people. How many people actually have email addresses, inboxes and all these things, right? How many people will actually go to their Gmail and type out an email? It's easier for certain profiles and a larger profile of people to call a number and talk about it. So in those scenarios, yes, either providing the number of the IC person is a good practice. In some places, if your external member is willing and they have that internal capacity and system and structure put in place, use that number. Or you can also use this number that you are talking about. The only problem is that at the back end, people should know that they cannot take an anonymous complaint because whistleblower allows you to complain anonymously.
Yeah.
Whereas workplace sexual harassment, you can do nothing about an anonymous complaint. And this needs to be told to people. So as a complainant, as an aggrieved, if I have called that number and I have left the details, right? Now in my head, what I'm thinking is that the company will surely do something, right? That's an expectation that the company will, I have done my job. But you should tell me that, you know, without taking my name, you should tell me that, okay, now we have heard you. There are two ways to go about it. One is this matter should be taken ideally under the law by the internal committee. So we will need some more information from you.
Yes.
Right. So that's a thorough communication. Because tomorrow what may happen, Colonel Sapore, is that if ever the HR still takes cognizance of this, okay, because it's an anonymous helpline, the HR still takes cognizance of it. What if the respondent tomorrow takes the company to the court saying that this was a workplace sexual harassment complaint, why didn't the committee take it up?
Absolutely.
Right. So that's the only caveat I would say that needs to be considered.
Absolutely. Fully agree with you. Thank you, Pallavi.
No issues. Any other question at this point? I have almost 2 pages of mistakes that IC members end up making. All right. The first mistake that IC makes is appointing a fact-finding committee. We talked about it in our previous sessions also. A fact-finding committee or a fact-finding person is basically one individual who is identified that whenever we receive a complaint, this person is going to do all the preliminary meetings and first make sure whether IC should even invest their time in looking into this complaint. I would say this is the biggest mistake that any committee or any company ends up making because yes, it is tedious to identify a quorum. Yes, it is tedious to tell those members that you have to be available for all these meetings. But in the absence of following this, there are 2 things that happen. One, the fact-finding person is relying solely on their own decision, which is exactly what this law wanted to make sure should not happen. That's why it said that all investigations should be addressed by a quorum of at least 3 out of 4 members. So that even if one person is thinking from their biased and their perceptions and their own judgments, the other two members will still be able to take care of it, balance it out. Second mistake that happens with a fact-finding person is, if ever that person does conclude on their own that no, this is a yes, this is a complaint that the IC should be taking, the parties involved in it will have to go through the procedure all over again. A fact-finding person is also meeting them and asking them to walk them through the incidents. The fact-finding person is also asking them for witnesses. The fact-finding person is also asking them to share the details of the evidences and cross-examining them. And after all these things, if the person is going to conclude that yes, IC should take it up, the IC, after appointing a quorum, is again going to go through all these activities, because now they have to document these things. They cannot use the documentation created by the fact-finding person because they were not in line with the quorum. This repeat experience creates an added trauma for the complainant, and it can be taken in the higher court of law as a violation of this law. There are judgments around it which have already included that if the committee does not handle the matter or the complaint brought by the complainant in a sensitive manner, then they have also been penalized under it. The second mistake that IC does is keeping meetings verbal. They get on a call and they will just talk to the aggrieved about something small. They will, even internally as IC members, they will quickly get on a call, they will discuss something important, and they will be done with it. They will have a quick 15 minutes meeting. They will have meetings with witnesses. They will have conversations with HR, and they're having all these conversations in a verbal manner. What they are failing to understand is each and every conversation that is being done for a specific complaint or set of allegations has to be maintained as part of the case file, which is the right of both the parties to access if ever they want to appeal to the higher courts or even to the labor commissioner. But in the absence of this, even a single meeting document missing is a technicality flaw. It's a violation. And even if the person's case is for trauma or is for improper investigation, the only thing black and white is improper documentation done during the investigation, which can be easily proven in the court of law. So when IC meetings, we have talked about it in our previous sessions also, we will be doing more and more sessions around it. But every meeting, every conversation that internal committee does has to be documented. Another mistake that IC does is exchanging notes with HR. We are currently part of an investigation wherein IC wanted to take a certain decision, and then they are so hell-bent on actually checking with HR whether they can take this decision or they cannot. They want to terminate the person, and they want to check with HR whether they can terminate the person or should they ask the person to resign. This is not a decision that you need to discuss with HR. The very act, and tomorrow if it gets proven, is something that is a violation of confidentiality under this law. Sometimes IC also wants to exchange notes with HR with respect to what is the prior conduct of that specific person. Whereas the law says that you do not look into person's prior conduct. The only time you need to look into a person's prior conduct is max to max whether they were previously alleged of sexual harassment. And even that should not be taken into consideration, except for rare instances where maybe in the previous allegation, this respondent was given a warning that if there is any repeat allegation against you and it gets proven, then you will be relieved from the organization. That's the only thing that you need to know, whether there was any warning that was given which can influence a decision this time. But no other prior information or additional information is necessary. But we have seen IC checking with HR about attendance. We have seen IC checking with HR about how much a person drinks during office parties. All these things you do not need to check with HR. The role of IC is to investigate based on the facts and the other information which are relevant to the case. not about creating a character profile of that person. Not maintaining a set.
Pallavi, I had a question here. Then one thing that you said, that the IC should not ideally be going back and checking with the HR on the attendance per se, for example, or on the performance reports. Now, what if the attendance and the performance reports are actually essential to the investigation of the cases? Isn't then it is required that IC should be able to have access to these documents?
No, that's a different thing. Getting access to the document is very different, Preeti, from actually discussing things. When I say exchanging notes, you can ask the HR that we need to know the attendance records of this person. But in return, you don't need to tell the HR why you need it.
Oh, of course, yes.
Right. So that's what we are saying. See, IC on their own have the right to collect as much information as possible. But what the HR thinks about a person and also giving any information in return is something that IC should be very careful about.
Yeah, I understand.
That's the difference. That's the only difference. And why you're needing that information also, right? So let's say if the attendance related thing is because, let's say the respondent said that, I think this person has brought a complaint against me because I have been telling this person that if you will take this many leaves and absences on important meeting days, then, this will be very difficult for me to maybe submit your name for an important project. Or whatever. There are counting allegations based on this. Then you need this information that whether there were actually that many leaves and absences which were taken.
Yeah, something that. Relevant to the cases or not. Yeah, absolutely. That's what I said. Yeah.
Another mistake that happens is not maintaining a set quorum. And when I say set quorum, it's in two things. One is the number of members in the quorum, which should be at least three. The second thing is not the same members. Please always keep going back to any civil court proceeding. It's not as if one day there are three members who are sitting and the next meeting, one of the judges is not available. So somebody else comes in and replaces them. And in the third hearing, one more additional member comes in because today they have time and they would like to be part of this investigation. Please maintain a set quorum. Not just in terms of numbers, but also the members who have been identified as part of the quorum. What it does is it actually creates additional discomfort for the complainant as well as for the respondent also. Because in my first meeting, if I met three members and have already answered their questions and I've already established that comfort or rapport or a certain wavelength with those people, if in every meeting a new member comes in, they will also have their own questions. What if they end up asking me questions that I have already answered? What if their presence is actually not aligned with the rest of the members? These are small, small things that the law expects internal committee members to know on their own, but it is also very difficult because it's not just any other functional meeting that is happening. It's a meeting, it's an investigation, it's a proceeding which is happening in line or in an equivalent role as a civil court proceeding. And sometimes it becomes very difficult to be mindful of this, that it's not just the number of people that we have to ensure, but it's also the same people who should be part of it. So a good practice will be when a complaint comes in, please ask your individual members, this is the complaint, who all will be able to commit to the meetings which will get appointed, and then make sure that they are there for all those meetings and they're not getting replaced in between. Another mistake is skipping timelines. The law is very clear on when what should happen. If a complaint has come in, within how many days the complainant should receive a response. If a complainant wants to file a complaint to the police, internal committee and the company management should ensure that all necessary support is provided. And this should be done within 7 days of receiving a complaint. Now, within 7 days means that not only an IC should be able to respond to the complainant, but they should also at least do their first meeting with the complainant in the first 7 days to get their declaration whether they want to file a complaint to the police or not file a complaint to the police, because the onus is on the committee. if later on the complainant says that I want to file a complaint to the police and the committee never presented me with this opportunity because they would not know. Ideally, a woman, or generally a woman, will always think that if I want to go to the police, then I'll be considered a troublemaker and the company will not provide me any support. Whereas in the law, it is written that if she wants to, then IC should make sure that it is filed within 7 days period. So your first meeting with the complainant should happen within 7 days, wherein you do introduce her to this particular opportunity or option, whichever word you want to use, and make sure that they understand that the decision to not to go to the police is their own. Now, some ICs decide it on their own, wherein they decide if a matter is very extreme to be brought to the police and whether they should introduce this provision, this option to the woman or not. But our recommendation is that even the Section 354 of IPC, which talks about outraging the modesty of a woman, looks at incidents as simple as somebody holding my hand without my knowledge, or somebody giving me a hug, or making a physical contact, or singing a lewd song in my presence. Section 354 recognizes these very, very, very basic experiences that women go through. So it is not on the ICC, it's not up to the IC members to decide whether an incident is serious enough or grave enough that they should introduce this option to the complainant. They should just introduce this option to her, and it should be done before the 7 day duration gets over. This is just one of the timelines which we have seen IC members skipping very commonly. But other than that, there are so many other timelines which are there. The number of days in which the respondent should provide their response. After their final decision meeting, how many days before the report should be filed? Once you have taken the decision meeting, maybe it's one meeting, two meeting, three meetings, within 10 days, your report should be filed. Your report should be shared with the management and the respective parties. All these timelines are very crucial to be adhered to, because in the higher court of law, the easiest things to prove are all these things, whether the quorum was maintained, whether documentation was there, whether timelines were being adhered to. These are very black and white areas. The subjectivity and the bias and everything else is still difficult to prove. But these are all very concrete things that can be highlighted and can be proven also. Another mistake that IC members end up doing is once they are done with the investigation, they send the inquiry report and the recommendation report to the HR instead of the management. It is not the HR. HR may end up implementing the decision. If somebody has to be demoted, somebody has to be transferred, somebody's salary needs to be reduced, and any decision that the internal committee has taken. But in the law, it's written, it's clearly mentioned that the inquiry report has to be submitted, the decision has to be submitted to the management, to the employer, and employer has to implement it. But of course, the employer will not implement it. They are not going to go and demote. They are not going to go and make the changes in the salary structure. The employer can then send it to the HR for implementation. But what should not happen is bypassing this whole step and for IC to send their inquiry report and recommendations directly to the HR. Next mistake is not addressing conflict of interest at the beginning of an investigation. Very crucial, at the same time, most commonly done mistake. Whenever a complaint comes in and you know, this is usually we say that it's the job of the presiding officer, chairperson who should be taking care of it. Not only ask themselves, but when a complaint comes in, please conduct a meeting, even if it's virtually done. Please call the IC members and understand who all can be part of it. This goes very well hand in hand with setting your quorum. Ask which members can actually take out the dedicated time for the next 3 months. That's a maximum period for looking at addressing this particular case. Who all will be able to devote their time? And then next, ask them whether there's any conflict of interest. It should be identified and cleared out in the beginning when you're appointing the quorum and not later on. Because later on, if it is found out, your you will either have to go through the whole procedure all over again, or if you continue with the investigation, there's always a big risk that this person, either complainant or the respondent, whoever is not happy with the decision, can take this up in the higher court of law that this was a biased investigation. What are the different instances of conflicts of interest? Today, we will not be able to address it, but in the upcoming sessions, we'll definitely take it up. That what exactly does the law mean when it says that there should not be any conflict of interest for the IC members during an investigation? Another mistake that internal committee members do is not meeting regularly and maintaining their MOMs. This, I'm referring to the quarterly meetings. It's written in the law, mentioned in the law, that the IC internal committee members should meet regularly. Now, they have not told what should you do when you meet regularly, but the lawmakers are expecting that when the internal committee members who have been given training on how serious and how critical their role is in the organization, when they meet regularly, they will talk about issues related to why do we have so many complaints or why do we have no complaints? Are we doing sufficient awareness activities? Even though it is not their duty to do so, if the HR or the management wants, they can appoint this duty to the IC members as well. What is the pattern of complaints that we are noticing? Based on the patterns of complaints, can we create some specific provisions in the HR processes or in the awareness activities? Another pattern could be that some of the complaints that have come to us, people have mentioned that they approached their managers first and the managers told them some answer which was not actually very appropriate in line with what the law demands. Should we do a special session for managers? There are so many things that can be addressed. In addition to that, you can always do a knowledge upgrade session for yourself. Ask your external member to do a review of the latest judgments that have come out. You can ask your external member to talk about maybe the top three complicated cases that they have handled. It's a very good opportunity to do a knowledge upgrade if you're not looking at any cases, but this is what you're supposed to be doing during these regular meetings. Now, once again, law has said regular. The minimum that IC should be meeting in a year is at least once in a quarter. I mean, I've worked with companies where ICs meet every month, and it's such a beautiful thing to see that there's always something to talk about. They're always eager to learn more. They always want to know what more can be done. They always want to refine the process further. They want to standardize the templates. They want to create case tracking sheets. So much that they want to do, because there is actually so much work to do. If you understand the immensity of IC as a function. Another mistake that IC usually end up doing is not inviting external member to investigation meetings. Now, I don't really blame internal committees on this one, because this is usually a decision which is taken by the company when they're appointing an external member. There's a lot of cost element in it, but however, keeping that aside, having an external member in your investigation always works in your favor. They bring the best of the industry practices to you. They guide you. If you're a new IC, they guide you on how investigation should be done. Even if you're an old and matured IC, they still keep bringing their own worldly perspective and their experiences to you. In addition to that, an external member being part of the industry, they're always keeping themselves up to date with what's happening. Is there a new interpretation that has been decided by one of the judgments? They will share those with you. There's so much that an external member will bring in. If nothing else, they will make sure that nobody tomorrow in higher court of law can question the biasness or impartiality of this investigation by saying that there was no external member and all these internal members were thinking only about the company and not putting the larger picture on the mandate of the law while they were investigating. There's a reason why the concept of external member was introduced under this law, and keeping them as part of the investigation only works in a company's favor. Sorry. Next mistake is not presenting parties with brief on IC procedures and their respective rights. There are so many elements that any employee or any individual who is part of an investigation may not know, including the provisions related to confidentiality, that when they go out of these meeting rooms, they are not supposed to be talking to other people about it. They are not even mandated to answer to anybody's questions. Retaliation, they are supposed to ensure that they do not end up creating an environment for the other person which creates further hostility. At the same time, them knowing that if somebody else is treating them differently because they are part of an investigation, either as a complainant or as a respondent, nobody has the right to treat them differently. Documentation, for them to know that everything that is being spoken here in the meeting room is being documented and they have the right to access them as and when they want. Timelines, so many things that individual members do not know, which creates fear, lack of trust, and a lot of misconceptions in those parties, either complainant or a respondent and the witnesses also. Usually IC members jump straight into investigation procedure, assuming that the person who is sitting in front of them would have sat through the awareness session or would have read the POSH policy document and would know about all these things. But please understand, sit with a checklist of items of information that you will inform the person about in your first meeting itself. Like I said a while ago, a lot of ICs miss out on telling the complainant that they have a right to file police complaint and the company will support them in all necessary measures. Even this needs to be documented, because tomorrow, if the complainant says that I wanted to file a police complaint and the IC members told me that if I do that, then they can't do anything about it. It's her word against yours. It's her word against the IC. And it's also a clear violation of the law. Or if tomorrow either of the parties say that the committee never told me that I will not lose my job, or I was supposed to keep these matters confidential, it once again comes back on the committee and how they handle the investigation. So make sure in the first meetings with any individual that you're meeting in any capacity, complainant, respondent, witness, it's important that you first brief them about their rights, and anyway, you're documenting everything. Which brings us to the next point, that not maintaining sanctity of IC meetings and documents, including evidences. It was being handled in a much better way earlier, but as all of us are handling investigations from home, we do hear people downloading evidences, documents, listening to audio files on WhatsApp, because it is more difficult to upload a specific audio file on the cloud and going there and entering a password and then playing it, or watching WhatsApp screenshots and so many other things just in plain view. Please understand, these are part of court proceedings. These documents, these information, these audio files, downloading them on your phones or any place or any property where other members of your family or anybody else can actually easily access them. If tomorrow it is questioned and it can be proven, you have violated the sanctity of the IC investigations. Yes, IC members have their own life. Yes, IC members have to undertake investigations from their homes. Right now, so many judges are doing the same thing from their homes also. But that is why there are certain standards and procedures which are put in place. There's a reason why judges are not allowed to take certain case files at home, because they cannot afford that anybody else who should not be privy to this information is able to have access to them. The same way IC members should also handle these evidences. We have seen IC members listening to audio files in the presence of their family members because somebody was screaming in the background, and then we got to know that no, my family is having food and I'm just sitting on the side. Yes, times are difficult. Maintaining privacy is also difficult, but it could have been easily addressed by wearing headphones or using headphones. These are all very sensitive information. This is all very, these are all evidences. It's not just about an incident which is being investigated within the company right now. Tomorrow, the same case can be taken to High Court and Supreme Court. And you have to handle any information that is relevant to that specific case with the same seriousness and sanctity. It's ideal to create standard procedures on how documents and evidences and certain elements will be handled, especially from work from home. It will be very ideal for IC to actually get together and identify certain do's and don'ts of undertaking investigations from home. Next is not following up on the status of implementation. After giving recommendation and submitting their inquiry report to the management, to the employer, IC, the management or the employer has up to 60 days to implement it. And what it means by that is that within 60 days period, not only the decision should be implemented, but they should write back to the IC with a written confirmation saying that this decision has been implemented. If a certain person was supposed to be demoted, a proof of that should be sent back to the IC so that they can include it in the case file. If somebody was not supposed to be part of the organization anymore, then after their resignation or termination, that particular piece of document should come back to the IC and it should be part of the case file. What is the proof for IC in their case file that the decision that they took was actually, in fact, implemented as it is without any change? Currently, IC members do not follow up on this, and HR and employer do not also provide any status update on this. But because it's an IC responsibility and it's part of their accountability, we suggest that whenever the IC sends the recommendation details to the employer, they specifically include that as and when this decision is implemented, a copy and confirmation of the same should be sent back to the committee. Please include this in your email. Please include this in your letter. And please make sure that this happens and you include it in the case file. Last mistake that IC makes is not sharing case files with the parties. We have heard so many ICs telling us that we will just tell them the decision that has been taken. And then we will just let it rest to that. Please understand that any decision that you take, both the parties have the right to know what all transpired. Transparency is a crucial element under principles of natural justice. Ideally, the best thing would be as you're going about the investigation, as you're becoming privy to any piece of information, as you're doing meetings, to create this transparency and open sharing of information with both the parties, because unlike any other court of law, here they do not have any legal representation. They have to represent and defend themselves. So they need to know what all you as a court are becoming privy to. Keeping any information from them is actually a violation of this law. So at the end of an investigation, when you are wondering whether to share the whole case file with the parties or not, it's best to share it on your own because it is their right anyway. And that way you also make sure that there is a good faith wherein if ever either of the parties are questioning the decision of the committee or are concerned whether the decision was taken right, whether they should go about and appeal either to the labor commissioner or in the higher court of law, they should be able to study those documents and make a calculated decision on their own. And at any point in time, if they want to appeal in the higher court of law, they can always come back to you and ask you for the complete case file. So you owe it to them, irrespective. So it's better that when you are sharing the final recommendation, you share the complete details with the individuals. Or another option could be you can just tell them the decision of the committee and you can give them this option that there is a case file which has been prepared in an exhaustive manner. If ever they want to go through this case file, just let us know and we will provide you a copy of it. Either of these things are fine, just to make sure that you don't end up violating any of the guidelines under this law. Before we move on to the mistakes made by management, which is our last part, any question here?
Pallavi, just a small one, small point here. So when you share the case files with both the parties, so for example, in an investigation that I've seen, not related to sexual harassment, otherwise, the victim who reported a potential violation and the mm-hmm. violation was substantiated, a severe action was taken against the respondent. The complainant later went about telling others that, you know, I sorted out so-and-so person. I filed a complaint against this person and this person has been fired. This person has been demoted. So would it be okay to caution the reporter, the complainant in this case, to keep the findings and the actions taken as confidential, strictly confidential?
Oh, absolutely. Colonel Supuri, keeping, you remember this part where we are saying not presenting parties with brief on IC procedures and their respective rights.
Yeah.
Right? One of the procedure that people need to be made aware of is maintaining confidentiality, not just during the investigation, but even after the investigation. I mean, the formats of decision report or recommendation report has certain clauses as part of the standard content, which is confidentiality. In fact, under the law, violating confidentiality, the fine mentioned is some 5,000 rupees.
Okay.
Right? But you also have to understand that 5,000 rupees in 1997 maybe was a big amount. Right? But in today's time, what is 5,000 rupees? I go and talk to everyone in the organization that they go, like, see, I filed a complaint and now this is what I did to this person. Okay. Or maybe even some other person is talking about it. 5,000 rupees, you will ask me, the Pallavi, you have violated the law and here's a fine of 5,000 rupees. It's nothing, right? So what we'll tell companies is also that, please, the law is not stopping you from issuing a higher fine.
Okay.
So what you should ideally do, and this is something that I personally have seen works wonderfully, is as and when any individual, including the committee members, are becoming part of an investigation, getting them to sign a non-disclosure undertaking. Okay. But in that non-disclosure undertaking, please identify what are the consequences.
Exactly. Right?
The consequence could be as low as deducting 1 month's salary, whatever could be, right? Because for a person who is making 20,000 per month, that 20,000 is a big amount.
Yes.
But for a person who is making 4 lakhs a month, that 20,000 doesn't make any difference, but 4 lakhs makes a lot of difference.
Absolutely.
So no matter who you are, right? If you have violated and it has been proven, see, it also has to be proven, right? So
absolutely.
In a lot of ongoing cases, when respondents or complainant, they come to us and they tell us either during an ongoing investigation or post an investigation that this so-and-so person was talking to this and I heard them talking about it. Okay. We ask them to, one, give this complaint in writing that they heard. Then those people are called in by the committee that did this happen or not. So you have to investigate. It's not as if anybody can walk in and say that this person has violated confidentiality and the committee goes ahead and find them. The committee investigates it as part of any other, because all these incidents, even after a complaint is done and dusted, is still associated with the procedure of the committee, which is under a complaint investigation of sexual harassment.
Thanks a lot.
So I hope this answered your question, but you have to identify more severe consequences and you have to make sure that whenever anybody is becoming part of an investigation, they are briefed on it, that if they violate, this is the same thing that happens with retaliation also. In fact, in one of the cases that we were almost, writing the recommendation, we had only included certain actions, okay? But then we got to know from that person's senior manager that, you know, this person is very worried about what's going to happen, whether they will be fired or not. And can you tell me what is the decision that you're going to take? Like this respondent's senior supervisor reached out to the committee, and then we asked them that, did this person come and talk to you about it? And they said, yes, this person talked to me about it. And they spoke almost for 2 hours and they were really concerned and I was talking to them. So two things have happened. One, the senior should have never entertained this.
Absolutely.
So there was a fine for the senior, okay, yeah, for the supervisor. Second, we spoke to the respondent again and we asked them that after being told not to discuss this with anybody else, we told you that even if you want to discuss it with somebody else, bring them to the IC and have this conversation with them. At the end of the day, what is your conversation with them? That you do not know what the decision of the committee will be. Ask us this question. Anyway, that person cannot tell you what the decision of this committee will be.
Yes.
So because you have violated a guideline, an instruction which was clearly briefed to you, and we clearly told you what could be the possible consequences, we had to add that consequence also as part of the recommendation. And we actually created a separate clause that these are the recommendation based on the alleged claims. And this additional element is being put in as part of the recommendation because this person violated the confidentiality during the procedures.
Good one. Thanks a lot, Pam. That helps a lot.
Mm-hmm. Any other question on this slide before we move forward? Okay. So mistakes made by the management or the employer, where exactly do they go wrong? So the first and foremost is they do not equip themselves with understanding of their role and duties. And most importantly, sorry for the typo on the spelling, consequences under POSH Act 2013. A lot of founders, leaders, board members, companies, heads, promoters, they actually do not think that this is an area which is of their concern. Wherein they're making the biggest mistake, because if tomorrow any violation happen, nothing will happen to the HR. Nothing will happen to the internal committee. Nothing will happen to the lawyer who is counseling them. Nothing will happen to their CA or CS. If a fine has to happen, it will be for them. If the business license has to be canceled, it's their business license which is getting canceled. If somebody has to be put in jail, which is also part of this, the consequences of the violations of this law. If somebody has to be sent to the jail, it will not be the HR or the legal. The promoters will be sent to the jail. The problem is the employers or the so-called promoters are not putting effort to know that what is it that we will lose. For them, this is just another HR activity or another legal activity which can be taken care of by some awareness session or by putting the policy in place. Second mistake that they make is assigning duties of POSH compliance to HR instead of legal. The reason I'm saying it is a mistake is because legal individual, legal teams, they understand somewhere that what is written in the law has to be achieved as per the intent of the law. HR can be given the responsibility of operationalizing it, but making sure that certain things, certain activities, certain actions, certain elements are put in place is part of a compliance. These are time-bound, documented, mandatory activities. You please use HR as a support function, but the legal has to drive it. And if ever there are consequences that have to be decided internally, it should not be HR. It should be the fault of the legal which failed to tell the company, management, HR, any other individual assigned, what exactly the company was supposed to be doing. It's a compliance activity. It is not a human resource activity. It becomes a human resource activity only because of the awareness session. But even those awareness session needs to have elements which are legally driven and not driven based on the whims and fancies. Third mistake that happens is not creating an SOP and formal working mechanics of IC and other activities under POSH. Internal committee members are chosen out of the blue and given this appointment letter or just told formally or verbally that you are part of the internal committee. Who will train them? Who will ensure that they understand what the law is asking them to do? Who is going to create a formal structure of their capacity building? What kind of support do they need? Do they need separate space for putting their documentation? Do they need separate space to conduct the meetings? In addition to doing their day-to-day regular activities, IC members also carry on investigations which are supposed to be done in a legally and time-bound and a well-documented manner. If there are more than one ICs, then the process needs to be done. Even if for a single IC, the process needs to be standardized. There are supposed to be certain standard operating procedures which should be defined. All this investment, who is going to make? Who is going to take this decision? This decision, this importance can only be taken by the employer or the management. HR cannot take it. Legal can only guide the management or the employer to do it. But at the end of the day, this standard operating procedure and certain guidelines to make sure that the IC is able to do whatever necessary, and it's also provided in the law. It's the duty of the employer to provide all necessary facilities and arrangements and support for the IC to be able to conduct the investigation in a manner which is provided under the law. But who will tell the employers this thing is once again the question. The fourth mistake is not including audit and reports of posh activities as part of board meetings. This does not become part of the boardroom discussion, even though they are signing on a declaration which gets submitted to the Companies Act, which is there in the MCA. I mean, tomorrow somebody can find an ITI or somebody can just go on the MCA portal and check how many companies are submitting their board resolution on this one, vis-a-vis whether they actually have things on ground. Very soon, MCA will actually take this stance just like SEBI did and to start taking actions against companies which are filing these declarations but do not have any necessary support on ground to substantiate it. But this is not what it should take for employers, for promoters to understand that they have to have internal mandate of including this particular area of compliance as part of their board meetings. And the last is not creating a budget for this and assuming it as a social service. I think everything stems from this. It's a woman-related issue. Do something, do one talk, encourage women, empower them. But this law is not about that. This law is very structured. This law is very compartmentalized. This law is very detailed in how it should be implemented in workplace. In addition to that, it comes with its own set of consequences as severe as cancellation of business license and the promoter being sent to jail. And yet it is looked at as a social service, and every mistake that we are talking about stems from this. So I know we extended the session a little bit, but thank you for all the wonderful questions. I want to now understand if we have more questions that we can address. Any questions?
No, Pallavi, I think I have no questions. So thank you so much for the session. I think it was very helpful.
Hi, Pallavi.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Preeti. Yeah. Thank you, Veena.
It was a great session. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We look forward to seeing you again in our future sessions. And if there are any comments, any question that comes as a after the thought, please feel free to email at contact@anjali.in.
Yeah.
You can also call me directly.
We will do
all right,
that.
Take care.
Thank you, Preeti. Sorry, Pallavi, it was very, very informative. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Have a lovely weekend, everyone. Stay safe.
Thank you, Pallavi.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. You too. Yeah.